constituents who have an interest in a primary role membership to develop. But Trends of ASEAN Integration, which is a multilateral economic agreement, revealed to us that ASEAN nations are still in the process of transitioning to a more coherent bloc, especially because there are major ideological differences between countries with chips. We're not even that integrated yet, and we need to be sensitive at a point in which, for example, ASEAN is still transitioning. That's why we think, but moreover, we think that the priority of ASEAN has always been economic development. We have the interest to maintain regional stability in terms of creating policies that are conducive to economic growth. But moreover, ASEAN resolutions have always been made unanimously, Mr. Chair, because if one country does not agree, the resolution will pass. We don't want politics to get in the way of pursuing its goals, especially when we're at a point in time, for example, where we cannot do that. Our clash is simple. We want to retain our non-interventionist policies and remain silent, for example, on moral and social issues that individual countries may face. We want, for example, to prioritize economic relationships in this sense, but moreover, we have to define what intervention means, right? Because Prime Minister never did that. A non-interventionist policy implies to Mr. Chair, that they will take a collective stand for not only a statement of condemnation, but also to the extent, for example, in imposing sanctions to countries, for example, where they may otherwise violate certain standards that the ASEAN may deem be against their principles. We think this is something that's harmful, especially when we want to prioritize maintaining this relationship as a bloc, because it's still vulnerable right now. What are the standards by which we need to assess it today? We need to assess, firstly, what is ASEAN's priority right now? But secondly, is ASEAN ready to be politically integrated? Because if the only thing that they want, Mr. Chair, is intervention, we have a lot of international organizations that intervene, for example, in humanitarian crisis. We have the UN, for example, we have NATO for military intervention, we have a lot of, we have even food costs for international courts, for example, for us to be able to clinch certain disputes within the ASEAN nation. We have the burden to prove, for example, why is ASEAN so crucial, and what's the nuance, for example, of ASEAN doing this when we can't rely, for example, to multilateral or bilateral agreements under their model. But a couple more responses before I argue. Because their main argument is
that ASEAN has a moral obligation to legitimize the ASEAN, for example, as an entity, for example, to realize its goals and what have you, to take collective action. But we think, Mr. Chair, that the assumption of this argument is that ASEAN countries want intervention from that specific bloc to begin with. We think that one of the strongest incentives that countries had in joining ASEAN was that it was primarily non-interventionist, meaning it wasn't a threat, for example, to the power structures that individual countries had in the first place. Because ASEAN countries, Mr. Chair, are distinct from each other, and they're divided on most social issues. Not all ASEAN countries, for example, are agree with the idea of letting Rohingyas in their country or even helping or correcting Myanmar, because some of them even agree, for example, to an extent that Rohingya Muslims should be discriminated. That's why it makes its decisions unanimously in status quo, because as much as possible, they don't want dissent internally, Mr. Chair and members of this House. But moreover, they have to prove under their side why ASEAN is the best arbiter to, for example, take collective action against these issues, Madam Chair, instead of a more holistic, for example, tribunal course in the international community if their problem is humanitarian crisis. Let's talk about my arguments, Madam Chair. The first idea is that we believe this is harmful to your internal relationship in the ASEAN. Because we told you, firstly, that the biggest incentive that ASEAN countries had to join the bloc was that it was not meddling, Madam Chair, and that it allowed for its members the space to make political decisions on their own, because these countries are culturally and ideologically different. For example, Brunei is a theocratic state, Ms. Madam Chair, members of staff. Singapore is a social democracy. Malaysia is a monarchy, Madam Chair. We think that it's difficult, if not impossible, for them to agree on political matters, especially because most of their views are polarized, Madam Chair. The only thing that they agree with right now is economic development. And the idea that they could coexist and pursue economic goals despite those political differences is why they're willing to enter into agreements with them, because these agreements would not be a threat, again, to those power structures or the way in which they govern their states. What is the harm? We think, Madam Chair, if you become interventionist under their model, if ASEAN country becomes like that, it makes countries less likely to be willing to cooperate with ASEAN programs, especially when politics becomes a key factor in deciding for rapid resolutions. It causes internal dissent, Mr. Chair, especially when your economic policies can be a tool for you, for example, to use in politics and threaten other nations, for example, in the process, for example, of pursuing development. The worst extent under their model is that these countries will leave the ASEAN as cause of global competition, which means the priority right now is to create a bloc with as minimal dissent as possible to give way to policies towards economic development. And that can happen when countries can use, for example, the ASEAN as a tool, for example, to manipulate its decisions against its entities. But on the second, are there any questions for six?
Madam, don't you think that no matter how different their political setups are, states do not have the right to oppress their own people?
We think, Madam Chair, it is conceivable because we agree that states don't have a right to oppress its people, but you have to prove why ASEAN should be the body to intervene on those matters, especially when we're at a point in time, again, that we want to prioritize our economic development. The second idea was we think this is harmful to our external, just to engage with them, the external representation, right? Because the goal of ASEAN is as well to invite as many countries to the bloc as we can. Because ASEAN is still a small bloc that it wants to grow, right? The incentive, that's why we need to retain the incentive of being non-interventionist. We need to get other countries to trust that the ASEAN is a safe haven for them to develop without the necessary bureaucracy for them to intervene with whatever political matters that they have on their own countries. This is how we strengthen, for example, our bloc with more members, manager, who are willing to trade with us, who are willing, for example, to engage in economic policies that are conducive to our nation. That's why we think that these states don't want, especially, a bloc. They don't want to enter into agreements. That's why, for example, there are in the case of EU right now, the EU, you see a lot of dissent, and you see, for example, talk about Britain wanting to end the EU as a bloc because it is too interventionist or it's too dissent, too different countries and members of the staff. That's why for us to maintain the integrity of ASEAN in terms of it being an economic bloc and in terms of forwarding, for example, better avenues for us to make sure